close the microphone here. So yeah, so I started in as a faculty member, and most of you probably already know this, but just to remind you, just over a year ago. So I'm 1 year ahead of Jessica, but still probably feeling the same way at the start of term. My position is one that is split between the Environmental Sustainability Research Center and also the Department of Geography and Tourism Studies. It's a Canada Research Chair, as Ryan mentioned. And this is the title of the Canada Research Chair, which also very nicely frames, coincidentally, my program of research. I guess my history in the ESRC and at Brock is actually much longer than a year. I've been here for 7 now, as a postdoc and then as a research associate. And during that time, I've worked with many members of the center, but primarily with Ryan. And so I don't know if are you presenting today on your own program of research?
Maybe.
Okay, you may see some connections. and that's just a function of, you know, the extent to which Ryan and I have worked together over the past 6 years and continue to. And we've really kind of, in some ways, co-defined a program of research. And as I'm stepping into this new role, I'm taking my research in some slightly different directions, but we still very much share a lot of common interests. So do not be surprised if you see links. I think you'll probably see links between many of us that speak today and explain our programs of research, because we do share some common interests, and that's what ties us together, even though we have very diverse perspectives that we bring to some of these issues, which is great. So how to put everything you do on one slide? It's not easy. And even, and trying to keep it still readable. But I would say my research right now kind of focuses on two areas that are not entirely distinct. So we have this joke amongst at least Ryan and I, but others too, about fuzzy boundaries. And it's hard to really clearly distinguish or create boundaries around any one topic and separate it from something else. But I will say that one of my areas of focus is water stewardship and governance. And this is an area that I've been working in for a few years with Ryan and other colleagues. And looking at the kind of the social processes that operate in groups that come together to make decisions about our resources, and in particular water. So that primarily has occurred at kind of a local, a regional scale, and has the potential to kind of expand in the future, which I'm really excited about. A lot of the work that I do is mixed method type research. So it includes a quantitative and a qualitative component. And as we expand this research, the potential to do more sophisticated quantitative analyses and start to identify patterns using statistical approaches is really exciting to me. Because we all know that context matters. But there are also some patterns that can transcend context, and that's where some of the really interesting stuff for me lies in terms of making change at a much larger scale and thinking about advice and directions going forward in terms of how you develop decision-making structures, bring people together and what that looks like to improve the outcomes of those processes. And so that's kind of how my interest in relation to environmental sustainability manifests in water stewardship and governance. I have a proposal, or I have a project that's starting now that you'll probably hear more about in a month or two, that looks at monitoring and evaluation. And I'm particularly excited about this. It's the first kind of big project that I'm leading as a faculty member. And it's looking at the different ways that we can monitor and evaluate outcomes from stewardship initiatives. And so it's a very, I think, a really nice example of transdisciplinary research where we're kind of designing a research project that has immediate applicability to our partner, which is, in this case, the Niagara Parks Commission, and has much broader potential applicability to many other organizations that are undertaking these sorts of initiatives, and really tries to create a decision-making framework for these organizations in terms of how they can engage in monitoring evaluation even when their resources may be constrained, and what are the trade-offs that you face when you don't have the resources necessarily to go out and do field collection, for example. So that's something I'm really excited about. The second area that I'm focusing on is water resilience. And so this term is one that's only starting to really be used in the literature. It largely comes out of, at least the way that I'm approaching it, social ecological resilience, which comes from a social ecological systems perspective, which Jessica very nicely identified as one of her assumptions that she works within. And so there's a few things that are happening within this space in terms of my own research. One is there's a book that's going to be coming out in 2 years, year and a half, hopefully. That is a co-edited volume by Ryan and myself focused on management and governance dimensions of water resilience. Brings together many kind of the lead thinkers in this area, and I'm very excited about that. We're also working together with Allison Quinlan from the Resilience Alliance on creating some conceptual clarity around what we mean and how we actually bring together these concepts related to resilience. So when we talk about resilience, it's not just resilience. There's a lot of discussion around adaptation and transformation. And so how do these different concepts kind of connect to each other? Where is there overlap? Where are there unique, distinctive kind of aspects to each of those concepts? And using that as a basis to move forward on identifying appropriate ways to assess resilience in a kind of a water stewardship or water governance context. So again, this is all work that's in the beginning stages, and I anticipate will unfold over a number of years. The final point that I'll touch on is water resilience endorsement, framing, and communicating. And this is a project that I have started as part of my position and brought a postdoc on, Dr. Jillian Dale, who has a PhD in psychology, and some of you may have already met her. You will likely see her around at some point. You will see her in 5PO2 for sure. And we're starting to look at the kind of the practice side of resilience. So how does society think about their water systems, and is that thinking aligned with how we think water resilience needs to be enacted? So this kind of social ecological resilience perspective. Our first attempt was kind of a broad survey of Canadians and Americans to assess to what extent they think the principles that underlie social ecological resilience in relation to water systems is important, and to what extent they agree with those principles. And as we move forward, we're going to make that analysis a lot more nuanced, and we think that there's a lot of really interesting and important information that will come out of that in terms of how we frame discussions about governance of water systems moving forward, maybe using terms like resilience, which can be quite vague and interpreted very differently, may not be the best way, and there may be other ways that we can do that. So I'm very excited about what's to come and excited about what I'm doing right now. And if you want to ever chat with me about any of this, my email is at the bottom, but you all see me in class every week, so.
That's nice, Joy.
Yeah.